Dr. Ajita, you may start with the introduction.
Good morning, Dr. Devesh. How are you, sir?
Yeah, good morning and namaskar.
Namaste, I'm
fine.
Sir.
Fine.
Okay, so let me introduce you first. So for our participants, good morning, everyone. I am honored today to announce with our participants that we are heading towards the end of this 21 days national training course on advances in veterinary research for sustainable development of livestock sector. So we are here for the first lecture of day 18, and we are obliged to have with us Dr. Devesh Thakur. And I welcome you, sir. And before we proceed, let me introduce our expert speaker to our participants. So Dr. Devesh Thakur is presently working as assistant professor at Department of Veterinary and Animal Husbandry Extension Education, DGCN COVAS, CSKHBKV, Palampur. He has done master's and PhD from ICR, Indian Veterinary Research Institute, Izzatnagar, Bareilly. He has 16 years of vast work experience as veterinary officer, then as assistant professor at SCOST Jammu, and later on at CSKHBKV Palampur. He specializes in veterinary extension education and has been actively engaged in teaching research and extension activities. In teaching, he has been engaged in undergraduate teaching and published 4 books, notably on entrepreneurship and social media use in extension education. In research, Dr. Devesh has formulated and is working on 6 research projects from National Innovation Foundation India, NABARD, and HIMCOST, out of which he has executed 3 projects as principal investigator and 3 as co-principal investigator. Besides, he has also been involved in 5 more projects as co-PI, funded by ICAR and RKVY. He has published 40 research publications in NAS-rated journals. In extension, he has organized several training programs for farmers, paravets, extension officers, and veterinarians, funded by Ministry of Agriculture, Agriculture Skill Council of India, and other state agencies. He has published 72 popular articles in various magazines. He also published 6 academic blogs in GFAR, FAO Rome, and Good Practices Note in Agricultural Extension South Asia, a dedicated platform of extension professionals for South Asian countries. His work has focused on on-farm trials on indigenous veterinary medications, undertaking technology demonstrational trials on selected animal health and production practices, livestock entrepreneurship, dairy FPOs, and recently community fodder intervention. So today he will deliver a lecture on this topic only, that is community fodder interventions for dairy development, a convergence approach. So we are honored today to have you with us. Without taking much of your time, shall we start with your presentation, sir?
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Ajayata, for giving such a elaborate, you know, details about me. So I would also like to say good morning to Dr. Sudesh, who is the course director of this program, as well as to all the participants across the country. As I was looking through the list of the participants, we have participants across the country and across all the disciplines of veterinary sciences, clinical, paraclinical. So this is just I'll be sharing the small work which we have done, but this work has a potential to scale up across varied agroclimatic regions of the country. So I'll start my presentation. So is the PPT visible in full screen mode?
Yes, sir, it is visible, sir.
Yes, okay. So this is my topic. This is already...
Sir, I think you are mute. No, sir, still you are mute, sir. Kindly unmute yourself, sir. Now we can hear you, sir.
So nothing was audible?
No, sir. You have to explain
something. Okay, really sorry for that. So thank you, Dr. Ajeta, and thank you, Dr. Sudesh, as well as a very good morning and namaskar to all the participants across the country. And I'll share my presentation about small work which we have been doing for last 15 months. So as the topic is already clear to you, this is about community fodder interventions for dairy development. So I would request the participants to maybe answer this question in the form of they can verbally respond or they can type in the chat box. So what do they think that, you know, in terms of yield gap, what factors is contributing maximally to economic losses in dairy production in India? Just think about this question. You can type in your chat box or you can respond, which is the main factor which is causing huge losses in terms of yield gap. Yield gap means our cows should give maybe 3,000 or 4,000 liters per lactation, but they're only giving 1,000 liters per lactation. So what is that which is causing a yield gap and resulting in economic loss? Now, if your answer is constraints in feed and fodder, then how much, what percentage of feed and fodder they are contributing to the economic loss? Maybe economic loss out of 100%, what percent they are contributing in terms of economic losses? So I could find a useful study which was done by two economists of National Institute of Agriculture Economics and Policy Research. And what they found is that there are four major factors which are causing maximum economic losses in dairy production. Number one, feed and nutrition, breeding problems, health and management. And out of these, it is the feed and nutrition which is causing almost half of the total economic loss in India. We can see in this graphical representation that almost half of the economic losses in dairy production in India, they are because of feed and nutrition. And in feed and nutrition, what are the four major factors as per the study? It is the scarcity of feed, dry fodder, green fodder, and mineral deficiency. And, you know, mineral deficiency is somewhere related to scarcity of the fodder. So the major challenge for sustainable dairy and livestock production remains the feed and fodder scarcity. If you look at this particular graph, you see in the blue line, this is the supply of dry fodder over the years from 2010 to 2050. And on the red, you see the demand. So there is a persistent demand supply gap for dry fodder, as well as a persistent gap in the supply and demand of green fodder. So our animals are not being fed properly. They are underfed. They are malnutritioned. So this is, I would say, the number one challenge in Indian conditions, that until unless our animals are fed properly, we cannot expect them to be healthy, to be disease-free, and to produce optimally. So as we see that across the country, there is a severe shortage of fodder, particularly the green fodder. This is a slide which I've taken from the Down to Earth. And you can see the country faces severe fodder shortage. Now, coming to our concept of fodder bank. So why we need to go for fodder bank? Because in fodder bank, we can cultivate green fodder. So when we go for green fodder, everyone knows that, you know, when we go for green fodder feeding, we can reduce the cost of production. You know, everyone is talking about doubling the farmer's income or increasing the farmer's income. There are two ways. One is to enhance the income through output. Another is to reduce the feeding cost or to reduce the input cost. So from that point of view also, we can increase the income, and to increase the income, we need to reduce the feeding cost, and that feeding cost can be reduced by cutting down the cost of, by going for green fodder. And of course, studies say that we cannot increase the area under fodder because it is being used by other cereal crops. So one of the ways to augment fodder production is community fodder banks. Now, what is a community fodder bank? This is nothing when a group of farmers, they come together and they grow grasses, they grow trees, legumes in largely wastelands. So that fodder can be used during lean period. And this fodder not only, you know, provides fodder to the animals, but replenishes the soil, improves the soil quality of that area, which is also, you know, very useful from environmental point of view. So with this background, I would like to share the work which is being done by Dr. G.C. Negi College of Veterinary Sciences, Palampur, in community fodder intervention. So basically, it is a convergence approach. It's kind of four or five organizations which are working together. Of course, our department, the Extension Education, is actually implementing this project. And then we have an NGO, an associate organization of Tata Trust, which is helping us in community mobilization. Then NABARD has supported us financially. The self-help groups of our areas and the PRIs, they are supporting us. We have support from IGFRI Palampur. Of course, Dr. Sudesh, the course director, is involved in this project. Then we have support of agronomists from AICRP on forest crops, KVK Kangra, and of course, we're taking support of line departments, especially Elmismendi department. We're seeking services of veterinarians to guide farmers about various programs. And many times, you know, ultimately it has to be treated by the animals are to be treated by the veterinarians. Then we are seeking support of agriculture to make farmers. We are actually using a cafeteria approach. And this, you know, this cafeteria approach you see in the private sector, you know, take the example of HDFC. So HDFC is also providing a banking services, insurance, general insurance, life insurance, or maybe in housing, because HDFC knows that their client have, same client have different kind of needs of services. Likewise, our farmers, a farmer may be a dairy farmer, but he may have requirement for, you know, cereal crops, maybe related to forest. So we need a cafeteria approach for our farmer. And that is what we are following in this particular project. Now, how did we select our project area? Actually, in these areas, we are already working for last 4 years in joint extension activities, and our partner was working over there. So we were well versed of the area. We had conducted baseline surveys. So that is one reason we selected these villages. Second is, of course, these villages have, every household has a dairy animal. And the women, they are the major force in dairy farming. Not only in this region, we see nationally also, women, they form the predominant workforce in dairying. And that percentage goes higher in this area where we are working. So after we select the villages, next point is what we do. We mobilize the communities through SHGs. We make self-help groups, and then we sensitize them about the kind of activities which we'll take up in the project. We explain the concept to the SHG members. Simultaneously, we also reach out to the PRIs, to the Panchayati Raj institutions, and we tell the representatives about the concept. And then these PRIs and SHGs, what they do, they themselves explain that concept in the Gram Sabha meetings. Afterwards, what we do, we go for the site selection where we are going to, you know, set up a community fodder bank. And generally, we prefer an area which is close to farmers so that, you know, once the bank is ready, the fodder bank is ready, the farmers, they can use that fodder easily. So it has to be close to the farmers' households. Normally, we are using wastelands and the CPRs. And this site selection, again, it is done jointly by the project team, by the officials and the local representatives. And once the site is selected, then a resolution is passed through Gram Sabha for the allocation of sites and funds. And also, we ensure that SDG members, they also contribute a minimal share so that only the serious beneficiaries, they are there in the intervention. So this is one of the area which we had selected last year in the village Kandral. This is another area which we selected last year. In the picture, we can see is our former head of our department, Dr. A.K. Panda. Now, after the site selection is done, what we do, because most of these areas, they are, you know, wastelands infested with lantana. So land preparation, the cleaning of the land is the first step which we do through the MNREGA funds. Then after cleaning, we go for trench creation. So we create trenches to conserve water and to go for plantation later on. And we also create pits to, you know, dig plants. Also compost pits have been created in these areas. The purpose is to, you know, reduce the erosion of the soil and increase the moisture level over there. Then based on the suitability of the fodder crops for the region, we selected these particular five grasses, NBH, Ceteria, Paspalum, Brachiaria, and Super Napier. So these were the fodder grasses which we did, which we selected, and the plantation we did in mostly in the rainy season, because that is the time which is more suitable for growth. And then we ensured that these good quality grasses, they are taken to the villages from our campus as well as from the IGFI regional station over here. And afterwards, we go for the fencing, because, you know, if we are going to set up a community fodder bank, this fencing is extremely important to protect the area from grazing or theft or any kind of damage. So fencing is very important. Then we go for routine visits and talk to the farmers, talk to the beneficiaries over there about the progress of the fodder bank. Besides grasses, we also go on for plantation of the fodder and medicinal trees. And some of these trees we have purchased from the Department of Forest, and some from our campus, from our university. So this is, you can say, the timeline or the series of sequences which I just discussed, that how to go for a community fodder bank. The first step is to, you know, create SHGs, then meetings with the SHGs, and then meetings with the PRIs. And then, you know, that once that is finalized, then the budget allocation by the panchayat, especially to land preparation. And then, you know, that resolution is passed through the Gram Sabha. Afterwards, we go for site selection, land preparation, creation of trenches, plantation, monitoring, and then comes the first harvest. So in our case, in our experiences, it took almost 10 to 11 months for the grasses to give the first harvest. So this is, you can see in this picture, I had shown you the slide before. This is the very same area of that particular village. This was a weed invested area, and now you can see after 1 year a community fodder bank has been created. This is another community fodder bank which you have created. Previously it was a area infested with lantana, and now you can see Cetaria and other fodder crops which are being grown over here. This is, you can see the in pictures we have tried to show how an weed infested area has been cleaned, and you know, the good quality fodder has been established in this particular area. So the first harvest we received, we established the fodder bank in July and August last year, and the first harvest was taken in June and the second in July 2021. So this is the photograph of the beneficiary farmers who harvested these grasses. And we also ensured that, you know, the weighing of the fodder was done to calculate the quantity of fodder which was produced in a particular community fodder bank. So these are the proud beneficiaries at the community fodder bank in a particular village. This is another community fodder bank which we have established. This is in village Kodpet. This is one more community fodder bank which we have established. And this is another community fodder bank. We can see the pictures of beneficiaries along with the fodder which they have harvested. Now the members, they are reaping the benefits of high quality fodder at their homesteads and near to their houses. So this is a video. So is the video audible, Dr. Ajayata?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes. It is well audible, sir.
Okay.
Sir, if possible, raise the volume.
Okay, I'll try it.
पशु विभाग पालमपुर उत्थान संस्था पंचायत के संयोग से एक चारा पार्क बनाया गया, जिसमें कई किस्में तैयार हो रही है और घास भी बहुत अच्छा तैयार हो रहा है, जैसे नेटेरिया सुपर नेटेरिया जैसे घास तैयार हो रही है और हम लगातार इसको काट रहे हैं और पशुओं को खिला रहे हैं और पशु पहले से ज्यादा दूध दे रहे हैं। हमारे लिए बहुत ही अच्छी बात है। हम सब गांववासी पंचायत निवार और वेटनरी कॉलेज उन्मुखा संस्था इस योजना के लिए बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद करते हैं।
So she talked about the convergence among all the institutions as well as the benefits of a community water bank. So this is the growth after 1 month. So this is the same area which we had harvested. We had a harvest on 4th of August, and now you can see almost after 1 month the fodder is again ready for harvest. So that is the beauty of community fodder bank, that the farmers, they'll get fodder again and again, and that too of good quality, having high quality protein and other nutritious, you know, elements. So this is the picture where you can see the difference in terms of local grass from an equal area and the superior grass which has been grown in the fodder bank. So that is the difference. And we have also estimated the total fodder production in that particular bank. So what we do actually, we go for the estimation of trench size, and then we weigh the total grass from that particular trench, and then we multiply with the total number of trenches in that particular fodder bank. So that is how we go for the calculation of the superior fodder production in a particular fodder bank. So in 1 year we have created 4 fodder banks in an area of 1.5 hectares each. most of these areas, they were covered with, you know, lantana. They're not being used. They were wastelands. And out of the five fodder grasses, which I previously mentioned, three, that is NBH, Cetaria, and Super Napier, they have been successfully established. And total yield, if we have to see, so 34 quintals of superior fodder, ranging from 34 quintals to almost 70 quintals of superior. And also we had growth of local grass. So in total, we had 156 quintals to range to 176 quintals from each fodder bank. And besides, we have also grown tree species, which will be growing over the period of time. Now, protection and management is extremely important when it comes to the community fodder bank. And each bank has been assigned to the SAG members. And the SAG members, they are responsible to protect the bank from grazing or damage or theft. And further, what we have done, within the bank, each part has been allocated to a particular member. So that particular member will take care of that particular part, and then they'll harvest from that particular part. So that is helping us to protect and manage the fodder banks. So this is the approximate cost of setting up of community fodder bank. So based on our experiences, maximum was on land preparation, which was through MNREGA, followed by fencing, in which NABARD and Himothan, they contributed. And then we got the grasses under various schemes from IGFRI and CSKHPKV. So the total cost is 1,18,000. And if we add another 15 to 20,000 for grasses, so it comes out to be, you know, around 1,30,000 for setting up a community fodder bank of 1.5 hectares. So this is a very nominal cost. And at such a nominal cost, we can, you know, create such community fodder banks. So these are the upcoming community fodder banks for the present year. This is another community fodder bank which is proposed for this particular year. This is the third one. Besides these community fodder banks, we have tried to establish the village fodder nurseries, where some of the farmers, they were interested to set up those nurseries, and now they are, in fact, they are able to earn little money from these banks, these nurseries. And these nurseries have been established to, you know, ensure good quality grasses, not only for the villages, but for the fodder banks as well. This is another nursery where a fodder farmer or an entrepreneur has established fodder grasses as well as local trees. So this is another fodder nursery. One of the beneficiaries is a woman farmer. Besides that, we are also supporting, you know, propagating improved fodder seeds for the farmers. And there is a demand. All of these seeds, they are not being given freely, but on user charge basis. So we have good demand of fodder seeds, which means farmers are willing to invest in, you know, fodder production. And another point I would like to make here is that the landholding size here is very small. So even then, their farmers, they are willing to spare some of their land for the fodder production. So besides that, you know, it is important to encourage and motivate the farmers on not only for fodder, but all aspects of veterinary science, veterinary and husbandry. So what we do, we conduct theme-based village trainings, and there we also conduct some kind of demonstrations, and our focus has been on feeding. Besides that, we have taken up some of the common problems which farmers face over there in the villages. So these are some of the teams which we have selected. In every training, we ensure that there is a demonstration. So normally we go for feed preparation involving, you know, local feed ingredients, maize or, you know, wheat is there. Then cake, some cake is always over there in our village. Then mineral mixture we try to add, because what we find that, you know, farmers, they are not aware about, you know, how to make feed at the village level. Many times what they do, they buy a proper feed from the market and then they'll add a cake into it. So the concept of scientific feeding was not over there, but through demonstrations, farmers, they are learning better. Also, we go for, you know, the basic management of diseases. So we also go for, you know, demonstration of herbal medications against ticks or against mastitis. Then for mass awareness, we go for bigger, you know, meetings where we involve all the SSG members of nearby areas. And when, you know, that big meetings happen, the message spreads. So because of that, you know, now the panchayats of the neighboring villages, they are willing to work with us. So that is the benefit of conducting such large centralized trainings. Of course, when we conduct small group trainings, there we can teach them about a particular skill or we can demonstrate about a particular, you know, practice. But for mass awareness, we can go for the centralized meetings. We have developed training material. Then besides, now we say that this is the digital age. So we are using digital extension tools to reach out to the farmers. One of the videos I would like to play about the kind of demonstrations we conduct in the villages.
या मिनरल मिक्सचर जो कि पशु के स्वास्थ्य के लिए बहुत जरूरी है। तो ये हमारी जो है धरती जो है फिर हम अपने पशुओं को खिलाएंगे तो हमारे पशुओं के जो दूध में जो है वो बढ़ोतरी होगी।
Also, you know, farmers, they always learn better from their peers, from the real life examples. They've also made videos of some of the farmers who are really doing.
So, दोस्तों ये भी आप देख सकते हैं इन्होंने जो है बेसिक कुछ दवाइयां भी जो है रखी हुई हैं और इसके अलावा जो है ये दूध बढ़ाने के लिए भी जो है ये टॉनिक्स जो है वो अपने पशुओं को देते रहते हैं और अभी हम एक ड्यूस की फीड डाल रहे हैं और जो मैं हैवी मिल्क कर रहा हूं उनके लिए ये है।
अच्छा,
और बाकी
ये कौन सी फीड बता रहे हैं?
ये पावर लैक आते हैं।
सो द स्मॉल इंपैक्ट अबाउट द प्रोजेक्ट इज दैट वी हैव बीन एबल टू एस्टैब्लिश 4 कम्युनिटी फूड बैंक्स इन लास्ट 1 ईयर वेयर almost 6 hectares of area which was not being used, which was like a wasteland. In those areas we have set up community fodder banks. We have increased the fodder production. Almost 740 quintals of fodder has been produced in these fodder banks, and out of these almost 194 has been of superior fodder varieties. And this is just the first year. So for the in the first year, the grasses, they take time to settle on, and we are expecting that production will be increased in the coming years. Of course, our training programs has been focused upon women, because women, they are the actual workforce as far as dairying is concerned in this part. And in these trainings, women, they are learning about so many things, about scientific feeding, about fodder production. And what are the challenges which we are facing in these community federal banks? One of the major challenge has been the aftercare. So in some of the areas, we find that the weed growth, the weeds are growing, and initially the farmers were not very, you know, they were reluctant to go over there to remove the weeds. So what we did actually, we divided the plots to individual beneficiaries. And because of that, now this is a strategy to improve the aftercare of a fodder bank. So this can be a challenge when we are working with setting up such fodder banks. A second has been the non-availability of sufficient fodder trees, because the provider of fodder trees has been the forest department, government of HP, but they have their own priority. And moreover, the different types of fodder trees which we need, they are not easily available with the department or in the university. So because of that, what we have done, we have established our own nurseries with the support of farmers. And from those nurseries, we'll be filling up the gap in terms of planting material in the coming years. And of course, the topographical challenges there, you know, many of these areas, we are working in difficult, we have deliberately chosen the difficult areas where actually the beneficiaries, they need such kind of interventions. So that is also one of the challenge. Now, to summarize, I would say that whenever we have established community fodder bank, we need convergence. So convergence can be a good strategy. And because of that, you know, we have improved the community participation. The participation of women has been improved in many instances. We are receiving a request from the panchayat to set up such fodder banks. Already in the project, we are going to scale up the activity. And in fact, in the recent project review meeting we had at Shimla, so there the top brass of the NABARD, they from this particular these interventions, they are sending a proposal of almost 10 crores to the central government to scale up this activity across the state. So with this note, I would like to end my lecture. Of course, we published this detailed project work as a good practice policy note, and more details you can see in that particular note. So with this, I would like to end my lecture, and I would like to have discussion with the participants. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for such an excellent presentation. And first of all, I would like to congratulate you for the field work done, like converting the wastelands into community fodder banks and other interventions in this line and helping our farmers of our state. So if there is any question, I don't think so right now, there is any question in the chat box. Dear participants, you can ask. Okay. So, sir, shall we address the questions?
Yeah. So, there is
one question from Dr. Joycey Joseph. She is asking how concentrates cost can be reduced. Yeah. Please give some suggestions.
Yeah. See, one of the way, as I told in the presentation, is to go for green fodder feeding. So, you know, almost 8 to 10 kg of concentrate feed can be reduced. Almost 1 kg concentrate feed can be reduced by, you know, supplementing 8 to 10 kg of green fodder. So we can increase green fodder feeding. Another way is, you know, most of the time farmers, they go for purchasing of the feed, which is not only costly, but which may not be of superior quality. So we can go for a demonstration to prepare feed at the home. Another way is that we can encourage the farmers to go for group purchase. Now, this concept of group marketing in terms of FPO is coming. So instead of farmer buying solely, group of farmers, when they come together, they can buy directly from a wholesaler. So from that way, we can also reduce the cost of concentrate feeding. Then
from Dr. Suresh Ramalingam, the next question is,
yes.
Number of animals benefited from 1.5 hectares of community, yeah, that CFD area.
Yes, sir. So what we have done, we have selected SAG members. So an average 10 to 15 families, they are taking care of these fodder banks. So all the animals which they have, you know, 10 to 15 families. So the demand of fodder demand for the animals of those 10 to 15 families will be met through these banks.
Okay, sir. So then next question is from Dr. Muniyappan Nagarajan. He's asking, sir, among the grain fodder, which variety fodder do you recommend?
Well, again, it depends upon the agroclimatic conditions. For this particular area, we have gone for Seteria and Napier Bajra hybrid, and both have, you know, done well. And of course, now Super Napier is also getting popular among the farmers.
Okay, sir. Then from Dr. Mahamudul Hassan Khan, he's asking, sir, how did you choose the particular variety of fodder crops for a particular land? Again, you have answered.
Yeah, of course, we have agronomist in our team. Dr. Sudesh is there. Then Dr. Naveen is there. So as per the package of practices of the university, as well as the IGFRI, so based on that, we have selected the fodder crops.
Okay, sir. Then from Dr. Suresh Ramalingam, he's asking, from the presentation, most of the land areas not a leveled one. Please share the irrigation and fertilizing methods adopted.
Yes. Well, actually, you know, we advise the farmers to go for the fertilization for, you know, manuring or application of fertilizers. But our experience showed that, you know, farmers, they were not very, you know, enthusiastic to use fertilizers. So whatever the fodder crops they have, and normally it is also not advised to go for the fertilizers used, because, you know, fertilizers, they are, you can say, they should be used for the cereal crops. So we didn't use any fertilizer or any manuring because the farmers, they were reluctant. But in spite of that, we could get, you know, good fodder production. The area which we have chosen, we have good amount of rainfall, and based on the soil, we see that, you know, soil has that kind of moisture. So that was the consideration which we took.
Okay, sir. Then Dr. Mahamudul Hassan Khan is asking, what are the fodder trees do you recommend suitable for hilly region?
Well, based on our experience, we used mulberry. Mulberry is very easy to establish over here. Then we went for Bahunia varietà. So these were, Bhimal is also there, but, you know, Bhimal availability is less, but Morus is more popular over here and it is easy to establish. Bahunia varietà is also there. Lucinia we are going. So these are things which are going.
Okay, sir. Then Dr. Suresh Ramalingam, he's asking, if soil profile is done prior to CFD, please share whether you have done soil profiling.
See what happens, you know, doing the things in a lab condition or in a station farm is easy. But when you have to do in the village, then things are very difficult. You know, we have to find out an area which is not only located nearby to the farmers, but then availability of land, then so many other things, socioeconomic dimensions also. So we could not do that. Based on our experiences, based on the observation of the team, we selected the area.
Okay, sir. Then Dr. Papuri Talukdar, he's asking regarding wasteland selection.
That is a good question. So
shall I announce the question, sir?
Yeah.
Mostly it belongs to forest department areas or some private property. Then how to proceed?
Yeah. See, in case of private areas, it is easy. You can talk to the beneficiaries over there. Normally what happens in the village, in our part, what happens over here in Himachal, that we have common lands which are owned by, you know, 10 to 12 families which are living in a village. So we can convince them together, and together we can, you know, use that as a fodder land. For forest department, of course, we need to, you know, go for MOU. For example, here we were fortunate, the DFO is also a veterinarian over here, and, you know, that was easy for us. So, you know, we need to go for a written MOU sort of thing for those things.
Okay, sir. Then Dr. Muniyappan Natarajan is asking, sir, research shows that Napier contains oleic acid, which causes hypocalcemia.
So, you know, we need to go for millimixture feeding, and yeah, he's right. But still, I do not find any concrete feedback from the villager. Of course, I'm waiting that, you know, some of the farmers, they report such kind of feedback. But of course, that thing is there.
Okay, sir. Then Dr. Suresh Ramalingam is asking, please share average rainfall data.
Well, I can share it with Dr. Ajayata and then she can pass on to Dr. Suresh.
Okay, but as per our knowledge, Palampur is highly
rainfed area.
Yes, sir. I think this is all from the participants. So I conclude. Thank you so much, sir, for sharing your experience, your work and your time with our participants on this platform and for addressing the issues of feed and fodder scarcity and how we can do further to improve the livestock production. Thank you once again, sir. Yeah,
thank you to all the participants, to Dr. Ajayata and to Dr. Sudesh. Thank you.
You're welcome, sir.
Ajita, we can leave now.
Yeah, hello.
Yes, Majid, it's over.
We can all leave and join back at 2:30.
Yes, okay.